Okay, we are going to continue our fantasy baseball draft strategy. Kasey, we're going to start with position flexibility today. So when you're drafting, how much does that factor into your thinking?
I think it factors into my thinking when I'm looking at my bench or my reserves, because for baseball's a lot different than basketball, and you don't have a lot of position variability or flexibility with some of your studs or your main players who you're going to draft early. Most of them are kind of cemented in a position and play there all season long. There are the rare occasions where they can have second and third base eligibility, or first and second base eligibility, or maybe an outfield and an infield spot. And if they have those, that makes them all the more valuable than just somebody who plays one position. But that's only a tiebreaker for me if the numbers are similar between both players.
Yeah, I'm in agreement with you. I think position flexibility is actually what you look at kind of more in the second half of the draft. So actually, a big part of what we're talking about is how do you construct a roster? So with that in mind, let's just saying with position flexibility, you do want to probably pick a guy or two who can fill in lots of different slots later.
Yeah, and I agree with that entirely. And one of the things that's really helpful, if you can find it, is somebody who qualifies their position flexibility as catcher and another position. Because catcher, it is like the golden goose. Catcher is really difficult to fill, because the top catchers don't play 162 games a year. You're lucky if you get 120 games out of them. And those are only the ones who are uber healthy and uber lucky. So if you can find somebody who qualifies in the outfield or infield as well as catcher, that you can fill them in, that's incredibly much more helpful.
That's a great point, because the other positions, you probably will be able to get guys to fill in. You should be able to get to 162 games or close to it. With catcher, you're going to lose at least 40 games if you have only one catcher. And generally, this is something I want to ask you about too. When you're constructing your roster, I usually only like to have one catcher anyway. I'd rather give up those games than waste the roster spot on a second catcher. Do you agree with that?
I do, because if you have one of the four or five best catchers, the numbers they can put up in 120 games or 115 games are better than you can find if you have two second tier catchers who play a combined 162 games. And so, I will look for streaming options or those players during the season who may become much more valuable at the catcher position. You can stream a lot, or you can pick up off the waivers if it comes to a point where you really do need a second catcher.
And here's the other thing. If you draft a really good catcher and then you have a second catcher and you play that second catcher, let's say for 40 games, they might be terrible stats. Just terrible. You might a lot of catchers hit for very low average, so they're going to bring you down. So that's addressing position flexibility. I agree with you. We don't spend a whole lot of time on it in the beginning. It's just a tiebreaker. But in constructing your roster, you are going to need to consider the relative values of hitters and pitchers. What's your take on that, generally speaking?
In today's age, I generally value starting pitchers and closers higher than I do hitters early on in the draft. And the reason being is there aren't that many true aces who can get you 180 to 200 innings, 200 and plus strikeouts, a good ERA, a good whip. Just to meet your innings limits with quality pitching, I tend to value starters early. I'd like to get two of the top 10 to 15 pitchers in the first few rounds if I can. And the same with closers. I like to get at least one surefire closer and then worry about trying to build more closers after that. But if you wait too long and there's that run of closers and you're the 10th pick and you see like six picks before you or seven picks before you, all of a sudden the closer run starts, you start sweating bullets, making sure you get a closer who's going to get you some saves with decent peripherals.
It's a really good point. And actually, this is where position flexibility does come into play, not necessarily in how you construct your roster, but in terms of values. Because the hitters often have multiple flexibility, and that means there could be 25 good options at third base. But at starting pitcher one,
right,
you got to pounce on it then, or you're not going to get it. So I'm in agreement with you. You do have to balance your roster, though, between hitters and pitchers. Now, I did want to just say to the fans out there, if you haven't already, click subscribe, ring the bell for notifications, and put your comments below. And we'll be happy to answer them personally. At least I will. Kasey, you should do the same. Now, you do have to balance hitters and pitchers. in a typical league, I think our league is pretty typical. There's about 25 spots because it tends to mirror major league rosters. So is the balance 12 and 13? Is it 11 and 14? What do you usually do with that?
I usually try to have more pitchers than hitters, just because if I've done a good enough job drafting and I've done a good enough job preparing, my starters at the offensive positions should be helpful to me. And I only, if I get good position flexibility, because we keep coming back to that on your bench, where you have people who qualify at multiple infield spots or an outfield and an infield spot, you can fill them in a lot easier. Pitchers, especially relief pitchers, are so unpredictable. So I like to be able to have some, I guess, leeway or some room for error in my draft on the pitching side, where I can afford to drop a pitcher because I know I have somebody on my bench who can fill that role admirably.
This is making me think we need to do a separate segment on how to manage your pitching numbers. We'll get into that with like middle relievers and things
like that. Yeah, you're notorious for having no innings until like July, and then all of a sudden you fill them all at once.
I know, it's sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. So I'm adjusting that. But let's talk about how to use your bench spots. We kind of touched on it just now. What are the kinds of players you want to have in your bench spots? We've talked about position flexibility. We've talked about that you like to have more pitchers than hitters. Different teams do it different ways. I sometimes look at another roster and I'm like, wow, they have a ton of hitters. But then at the end of the season, they've made up all their games and I haven't. So there are different things that you're achieving with different bench spots. What are the types of bench players that you like to have to round things out and get you into a good spot to win?
I tend to like to have at least one speedster on my bench, one guy who's going to steal bases for me, hopefully score some runs. You know, unless you have one of those elite speed stars where there's only never more than two or three in the league at any one given time, you need to fill in for some of those specialty areas because, you know, the difference of 15 steals can be almost 8 or 9 points in your fantasy league because of the lack of depth of base stealers. I like guys who are predictable on my bench. I don't, you know, I like to have a lottery ticket or two, and I think we'll talk about that when we talk about risk. But in general, I want to know what I'm going to get when I put somebody in the lineup to fill in for one of my starters.
Let me just add a point to that. Your bench spots, you're best off having players that fill multiple needs. So a speedster can be a great guy to have, but you generally want a speedster who also at least scores a lot of runs and maybe has some good batting average. So of course you're looking for the best fit you can, but I appreciate your point. And when I think about like a speedster versus a backup catcher, you're much better off having that speedster. If you play a speedster, let's say for 30 games and you play a backup catcher for 30 games, the stats you're going to get from the speed guy are going to matter more in moving you up the ranking. So that's one way to use bench spots. Another one, you know, that I love is middle relievers. We just touched on it before. These middle relief guys, they tend to have more predictable numbers. It's not always true, but year to year, there's always guys that you see just have very low ERAs, very low whips, and they may only pitch 60 innings a year, but those are a great 60 innings. And in fact, if you have room on your roster and you can keep three of them, you just got an ace. Now, it's a lot to manage, though.
And they also can chip in saves for you because, as we've seen over the past several years, like closers' jobs are not very secure. And if you have a really good seventh or eighth inning guy who's getting a lot of holds with really good numbers, when that closer fumbles, which happens more often than we'd like to admit, that's usually the guy who steps into the role and can then be an extra valuable player for you going forward.
Yeah, so I would say that the kind of bench spots you want to use are specialists, position flexibility, extra relievers, and extra starters, because pitchers can get hurt. You need depth at those positions even more.
And there's, if I can point out one more, I also like, because we'll talk about maybe this more when we talk about risk, I also like to have at least one prospect who's close to the majors, who is a high value player, either in my offensive bench or on my pitching bench. And so there'll be one, I usually reserve one spot for a minor leaguer.
Yep, and sometimes two, because maybe you're looking at a hitter who's going to have a lot of upside and a pitcher, but you always want to balance it. If you've got four of those guys, you're going to fall behind in innings.
Bad juju.
You're going to fall behind in games played. You're going to start to lose ground. So you really have to figure out how to balance your roster. And when you're drafting, I think the strategy is don't worry about that at all for probably let's say you have 25 players. Don't worry about that at all for at least the first 15 picks. Yeah. Just pick your best players. But then you want to start thinking, how's my roster constructed? And you want to balance it with what you already have. So the other thing that I would say is another way to use a bench spot is if there's just a guy on the wire who is too much value but isn't the kind of player that you want, pick him up anyway, then make a trade. Make a 2-for-1 deal, use that value. That's a way to keep turning over the bench spots and keep using them for good things. And that's something that a good fantasy manager in baseball does over the year. You use that length of time to make as much gain as you can. So now, let's finish up on talking about assessing how much risk to take on and when. This is a big question. A lot of times people construct their roster, and when they look at it at the end, they have tons of risk, and others didn't take enough risks. So Kasey, talk about that a little bit.
I like to take risks. I tend to be more of a risk taker when it comes to the draft, but I won't do it in the first 10 to 15 picks at all. I want my core of my team to be predictable, to be you can put them out there, you know what you're going to get. You're not going to get the swing and miss rough patches where they go, you know, 3-for-24 with 20 strikeouts or 18 strikeouts. Those lottery tickets, I think of, are the younger players, maybe rookies who have the pedigree in the minors, or players who have been injured for a couple of years and are making a comeback, that if they can come back, can be transformational players for your team. Or if they develop the way that the scouts are saying they're going to be, can be transformational from your team. But, you know, even the Mike Trouts of the world struggled mightily in their first year in the big leagues. And so you don't want too many of those players, because then you don't know, your roster could end up being full of empty statistics or bad statistics, and it's hard to rebuild from that.
Yep, and it's hard to redirect your course if you're not balanced enough. There's also value picks you can fill in. We talked about that in the last video. Value picks are a good way to fill it out. They're just people who are just unappreciated for one team. Maybe it's a guy on a team that doesn't get a lot of wins, but he's a really good pitcher. So you could fill out your roster with that. I think the thing that we're highlighting most for draft strategy for the people who are, you know, setting out to learn this or maybe get better, is don't take your risks early, and don't fill in gaps based on position flexibility early. Don't do anything early that isn't just taking the most solid pick you can. Build that team. It's later in the draft that you bring in position flexibility, figure out how to balance your roster and get those bench spots set, and taking that risk. And you have to assess let's say you took two high prospects and you're going to wait for them. Taking a third, probably not a good idea. So when you're looking at which one to take, decide. You want to have a sense of how many of these guys to take at each position. Now, there's plenty of time to adjust in baseball. That's one of the things that we love about baseball. It's a long season, and it affords us all kinds of opportunity to send all of our trades to people and keep looking for ways to make gains. Don't be afraid to grab people on the wire also who have a lot of upside, though. Let's say, you know, the guy you drafted is not showing any value, but this guy is right now. You may want to pounce on it. It depends. If it's a guy who has huge pedigree, maybe you don't cut him then. But if it's 6 in 1, 1/2 in a dozen in the other, and one's already performing, grab the one that's performing. And this should give you guys some idea of how to build a roster. We're going to keep talking more fantasy baseball strategy as we go, all designed to get you to be the best player you can be. So if you haven't already, click subscribe, ring the bell for notifications, put your comments below, and hit like if you like what you're hearing. And we'll keep bringing the heat.